My name is Emily Beers, and I'm about to embark on a trip to the most impoverished country in the Western world. For the last 5 weeks, I've been consumed by the CrossFit Open, to the point that my stress led to a violent fever and a relentless cold. In need of perspective, I'm hoping this trip to Haiti will allow me to reassess the relative importance or unimportance of the worldwide leaderboard.
I am so ready after 5 weeks of judging my self-worth on one or two reps to be thinking about something else. This is really good.
I'm gonna be thinking.
The open is now closed, although I still haven't submitted my story.
Aside from the hope for personal growth, my priority for this trip is as a journalist. One of Coach Greg Glassman's goals for CrossFit is to help people become better, and not just in the realm of physical fitness. In light of this, Haiti is a perfect opportunity to learn about the world, and then share this knowledge with our community. At this point, though, I'm not quite sure what to expect.
That's the thing. I don't really know what is happening. Charity work in Haiti. Everybody's telling me that I'm going to have all these emotions that I'm not expecting to have. And it's like, what did you, when you first went there, what was it like? I mean, I know that was right after the earthquake, but.
Well, it's hard to say how you'll react, because I think it won't hit you till you get off the plane and it's 45 degrees. And we were just talking about how many people are going to try to grab your bag at the airport, and there's like throngs of mass chaos. So I don't think you can actually predict how you're going to feel until that moment when we get off the plane.
My name is Julie Roberts, and I'm from Vancouver, BC, and I work for an organization called Community Builders Benevolence Group. It's a bottom-up organization that helps in marginalized communities in Vancouver, Africa, Haiti, a bunch of places where there's really poor communities.
What is it about, like, you've been there 13 times, right?
This will be my 13th time. Oh no.
What is it?
Good thing I'm not superstitious.
Shit, seriously. What is it that keeps sending you back? Like, why would you want to keep going back to a place that is as hopeless as you say it is?
Well, I think for me, I have a lot. Like, I have so much in my life, and I have had a lot of really cool experiences, and I have a good family, and I have so much opportunity being born in Canada. But something that's always gotten to me is people suffering.
Like, I don't have any grandiose ideas that I'm changing the face of Haiti, but every time I go down, there's a little tiny bit more progress in this community that I'm working in, and I feel like I need that, or else I end up just feeling really overwhelmed myself for how bad it is. So.
A greater purpose that gives you something more important to do than waste time thinking about how many times I smoke my chest to the bar today.
It becomes quickly obvious that Julie is the consummate humanitarian. The woman is the president of a very successful nonprofit and a part-time paramedic. Oh, and as a single mother, she's also raising 4 kids under the age of 7, 3 of whom are adopted. Just hearing about her life starts to help me with my self-induced post-open stress disorder. The open. I can feel it fading away already. And we're not even out of Canada yet.
So, have you had any near-death experiences in Haiti?
No, I don't. Well, I mean, really, what
dangerous
death experience?
I have a couple other clients who went down, and they've told me, like, don't drink the water. Don't go out after dark. Don't drive where you're not supposed to drive. Nothing's really, I mean, necessarily 100% safe. So I think we do have to be careful.
I know there are reports of stuff happening, and there are areas of Haiti that we will avoid. But I've never felt anything but perfectly safe there.
The unknown terrifies me, but I also know that it helps you grow too, to be able to deal with not knowing and doing it anyways, and putting yourself in uncomfortable situations. And that's exactly what CrossFit is putting yourself in uncomfortable situations and then dealing with it. Hopefully, like CrossFit, you'll come out stronger because of it.
Luckily, I don't have to venture into the unknown alone. Kane Morgan, one of the other coaches from my box, is coming along. His nickname is Pleasantville. We'll need his calming presence.
My name is Kane Morgan, and I'm 26 years old from Vancouver, British Columbia. I'm a CrossFit coach, and then the odd few days I work down at a small local cafe in Vancouver.
Our last stop before the border crossing is to pick up the final member of our team.
My name is Jessica Coulter. I'm 26. I'm born and raised in White Rock, British Columbia. I'm a personal trainer. I did just get my level one CrossFit, which is good news, very exciting.
At this point, we're all a bit nervous. And Julie isn't doing much to settle our fears. Malaria is a very real possibility, she says. And there are no screens, let alone glass, on the windows of the house Julie rents in Haiti. So chances are, mosquitoes will circulate happily around us. Then there's the beach she calls Garbage Beach, which is allegedly covered in 2 feet of trash.
I don't know what I'm getting myself into when she mentioned that, oh yeah, there's no actually glass on the windows. What? And then the thought of malaria and mosquitoes. Garbage Beach, 2 feet of garbage, she says. Like, I'm picturing nowhere to lie because of garbage everywhere. That kind of thing would be like, oh, we're not going to paradise here. It's about 5 in the morning and I'm submitting my score because I'm scared I'll forget at this point. Is that plane ride? I don't know, are we in Miami? We're in Florida. Okay, Miami. So we're here for 6 hours now. So getting to Haiti is proving to be a process.
We definitely took the scenic route to Haiti and we're all feeling it. After these 6 hours in Miami, I'll be without internet access for days, so I submit my final open score. Already, it feels like the open was weeks ago. I'm so ready to be in Haiti, on Garbage Beach. I may even toss my laptop there for the stress it caused me this past month.
No, Julie's a little nervous, and when Julie's nervous, it tells me I should be nervous. So it's a little chaotic leaving that airport. I thought my bag might get taken. You were worried there for a minute. That guy tried to help me with my bag, and Kane was like, "Emily, no!"
We got to the airport. It was just a scene. There were people everywhere. It was the driving in the car alone, trying to get out of the parking lot, was an experience in the sense that we almost couldn't get out. It was just like a suffocating amount of people and noise and chaos and calamity. And of course, once we get on the roads, it just gets 10 times worse because any sort of logic you have of how road systems and driving ought to work goes right out the window.
Right now, we are heading to St. Mark, where it's a town very close to McDonald, where we're back. Whoa, sorry everybody, where the house is. And here comes a car straight for me. We're all good.
We free ourselves from the city of Port-au-Prince, nearly destroyed by the earthquake in 2010, and emerge in the countryside. Haiti shares the island with the prosperous Dominican Republic, a lush country with gorgeous beaches and a booming tourism industry. Haiti, on the other hand, has had a much different fate. From ineffective and crooked political leaders, to brutal slavery, destructive deforestation, and damaging natural disasters, Haiti's history is marred by tragedy and violence, by corruption and bloodshed. Today, half the population of Haiti cannot read, and 40% are unemployed. Julie is hoping that little by little, she can make a small difference. And she's starting with the tiny village of McDonald.
This is McDonald.
our little neighborhood.
Before coming here, I really had no idea what to expect, what our house was to look like. I was assuming dirt floors, cots, the bare bones.
After the initial excitement of booking a trip wore off, I was kind of worried because everybody had sort of a varying degree of exposure to countries outside of North America, and Haiti's a pretty unique place. There's a lot of poverty, there's not running water and electricity every day. Things kind of are on Haitian time where nothing always happens according to plan, and there's always some kind of excitement or adventure, so I definitely was worried.
It's smoking hot as we pull up to our new home. We're all anxious to check out our concrete box of a house.
So, we have electricity, so that's good news. This looks like an empty room. Everything's made of concrete. Oh, there's even screens on the window. That's luxury that we weren't expecting. The bed there is a sort of kitchen. We have a fridge, but I don't know what we have electricity for, so that might not work. Okay, so we got one bed here. Oh, and the good news is we weren't expecting a door on it. On the toilet, on the bathroom, so we have a door. I don't know if anything happens if you press that. No. Bathtub, but there's no actual running water. There's another room here. The bed. It's pretty much the same as the first room. And then we got the ocean. This is the garbage beach.
It kind of blew me away. I thought this was way nicer. Like, I was very surprised. I was like, luxury.
This is the backyard, and this is actually really kind of depressing. There's garbage everywhere, I guess, when you are that poor, you don't really care where you put your garbage, but it's pretty sad, actually, when you see this.
But before I could get too caught up in the depressing sight of Garbage Beach, it's time to take a moment of appreciation. And what better way to celebrate than to pop the cork on some warm champagne.
Alright, Jess. Kane.
Cheers.
Cheers to arriving.
When we got to the small town of McDonald, it became a lot more calm, a lot more relaxed, and I was very impressed with the warmth with which we were received by the community and how excited people were to have us here.
When we arrived, two local women arrived at our doorstep with food, chicken, rice, beans, and a dozen mangoes. Here they are, with barely enough food to feed their own families, yet they take the time to cook for us? We're the ones with enough beef jerky, dried fruit, and money to last us weeks.
Yeah, we got here and right away they had food for us. They're very lovely people. They're very welcoming, very, very welcoming.
Being in McDonald makes me feel boring and inadequate. I look at Julie. Prior to this trip, we were acquaintances at best. She was just a girl who came to the 11 a.m. class here and there. Yet, behind the blonde curls is this amazingly generous woman who has this other life venturing to Haiti and countries all over Africa, legitimately helping to make the world better. I'm so inspired. I pull out my notepad and pen and start to write.
It's weird. I don't remember the last time I wrote with a pen. It's so freaking slow. I always type everything. It's just like new culture, everything's so different from home, and like trying to piece it all together and really understand it, and I just feel very overwhelmed a little bit.
We only saw daylight for a couple of hours today, but tomorrow we're going to tour McDonald, and the mayor of the community has invited us to a town hall meeting where we will experience the soul of Haiti, both the hope and the despair.